Well, hello everybody. Thank you all for being here. And let's see, Ingrid didn't mention, is Lainey in the house?
Okay.
Well, I'm really happy to be here. It's not too often that I get to speak at a community college, so I'm really happy that this event was placed here. So I don't have a clicker, so I'll just be raising my finger each time. So the title of my talk is, It's Whom You Teach, Not Just What You Teach, Becoming Culturally Competent Teachers. And I want to tell you a little bit about why I wrote this. I've been in education for a long time. I was a middle school teacher, an elementary school teacher, and then a teacher educator. And I've come to realize that the students need to be the center of our efforts. The content is important, of course. So that's why I say it's whom you teach, not just what you teach. What you teach, of course, is really important. But unless we know who we teach, we're not going to make as big an impact as we could. So today I'm going to be talking about my new book, a book that's not out yet, that I haven't finished writing yet, as a matter of fact. But it's called From Surviving to Thriving, Finding Hope, or Finding Joy, we could just as well say hope too, in Teaching Students of Diverse Backgrounds. And I chose this title because too often when we speak about teaching students of diverse backgrounds, we focus on all the dilemmas and all the challenges and all the problems, a real deficit orientation. You know what, in Spanish I would say the Ay Bendito syndrome. Now, not too many people understand Ay Bendito, but for Puerto Ricans it means, oh, poor thing. So the oh, poor thing syndrome. You know, they don't have fathers. They don't go to museums. They don't have books at home. They don't get to plays. They don't have bedtime stories. So except for the fact that I was so lucky to have a father at home, all those things could have been said about me as well. So we did not have bedtime stories. We didn't have books at home. We didn't go to museums. We didn't do any of those things. But those things shouldn't put me or anybody else at a disadvantage. So, you know, it's really knowing who the students are that makes a difference. However, while I say that, I don't want to leave you with the impression that I'm saying that teachers are responsible for everything bad or everything good that goes on in schools. I'm not saying that at all, because teachers often work in very hostile circumstances, in a hostile climate. They don't get the support that they need. They don't have much autonomy with all the policies and practices in schools now that focus on high-stakes testing, on tracking, on all the other things that we are exposing our kids to. We're also exposing the teachers to. And so I don't want you to walk away tonight saying, you see, if only we had better teachers, everything would be okay. Having said that, if we had better teachers, things would be okay. Because teachers can do something, but they can't do everything. And so that's always my message. I don't want to get into a blame game that, you know, teachers are the problem. There's so much teacher bashing going on today, I don't want to add to that. As a matter of fact, I want to affirm and honor teachers. Some of the best people who I've ever worked with are teachers. And so that's why the last several books that I've written are all about teachers and about the difference that they can make. But please remember that until we change the structures of our schools, and I would also say of our society, to be more equitable, things won't change for the great majority of students. Okay, so I'm always in this balancing act. What can teachers do, but what holds them back? So I'll be mentioning all those things today. So. So the questions that guide this work today are, what does it take for teachers to move beyond surviving, to persist and thrive in the profession, and how do they engage their students as well? What do they need to know about their students, and how can they find joy in teaching? And this is, you know, sort of a different paradigm, because we often talk so much about the problems, and we should focus on what's wrong, but we also need to find what's right. The purpose of the book that I'm writing, and I hope of the presentation today, at least you'll get a glimpse of it, is to provide teachers and those who work with them a vision for thriving in the classroom and strategies for doing so. And to learn from teachers who are successful with students of diverse backgrounds, and to see how they become social activists and advocates for their students, and also how they remain intellectually engaged. Gee, I don't have all of this written down here, so that's why I was hoping I was having my computer here. So I'm going to have to take this so I can look back at the PowerPoint myself. Okay, next. So the theoretical underpinnings are, and I just want to say a word about each of these, you know, how I base my work. So one is inquiry, and that inquiry is a central element of teachers' work. That is their own inquiries, that unless teachers really focus on who they are, what they're doing, and why they're doing it, things won't get better. So inquiry and their own research. You know, every teacher is a researcher, really. But we need to work with teachers so that they understand that they're researchers. And the people I'm citing there are Marilyn Cochran Smith and Susan Lytle. That narrative is one method for teachers and for all of us to learn about teachers' work and what sustains them. And I'm citing Clinenden and others who've done work on narrative. That is, what are our stories? What are teachers' stories? So I have a couple of books and several articles and book chapters that talk about teachers' stories. One is Why We Teach, where teachers wrote essays about why they teach. And another is a book that came from research with teachers in an inquiry group that's called What Keeps Teachers Going? A question that I have thought about for a long time, besides the fact that I was a teacher, my husband was a teacher, and our daughter is a teacher. And so what is it that keeps teachers going is a very important question for me, because so many teachers leave the profession after a short time. About 50% of all teachers who work in urban schools leave after 5 years. And so we need to think about why that is and how to help them, especially, you know, the excellent teachers who are leaving, how to help them stay in the classroom. That teachers, above all, are intellectual workers, as proposed by Henry Giroux, and their work can be transformative in spite of the deprofessionalization of teachers. And the deprofessionalization refers to the fact that teachers' autonomy is taken away from them and that they're under a great deal of surveillance. That certainly happens in California, it happens in Massachusetts where I live, and it happens now all over the country where teachers are told how to teach, what to teach, when to teach. And as a result, because of all this high-stakes testing and so on, in many schools around the country, because the focus is on literacy and on mathematics and now more recently on science, that art is being taken away from many classrooms, but even social studies. Kids are not learning history and social studies because there's no time for that in the curriculum if they want them to have these high-stakes tests, to do well on these tests. And so that's what deprofessionalization refers to. Education is most powerful when it's based on dialogue and respect, and that comes from the work of Paulo Freire. If you haven't read Paulo Freire, I recommend that you do so. It's quite heavy duty to do so at first, but I always tell people just Read it 5 times. And I don't say that about most things. Some things I say it's not worth it reading 5 times, but Paulo Freire is worth it. And it's very empowering, and you know, you can just, for me, it was very powerful to read Paulo Freire's words about dialogue, about education for freedom, for liberation rather than for domestication, about the fact that while students can learn to read the world, that doesn't necessarily mean that they learn to read the world, and that was what his whole philosophy was based on. That multicultural and anti-bias education can be an antidote to the numbing authoritarian ideology, the rigid prescriptive methods, and the racist practices that accompany neoliberal policies of education. And I've listed a bunch of us there. So, and Gloria Ladson-Billings, who I knew was here. And Christine Slater, she has not been here, right? Oh, that's a good person to get here to. So that's the theoretical underpinnings. And the organization of this book will be in terms of vignettes and case studies of teachers who are thriving based on interviews of teachers from around the country who have been recommended to me as thriving. That is, they're effective, they're excellent, they're caring, and they're intellectually engaged, and they teach students of diverse backgrounds. The interviews focused on both the conditions in their classrooms and their schools and society that help or hinder their thriving, and on how they manage to thrive in spite of so many times negative conditions. And so these are some of the teachers who I've interviewed over the past, I would say, 3 years probably. The book is having a long birth. So far, I've interviewed about 20 teachers, and I think that will be it. Now I have to get down to writing. I'm going to focus on the ones on the top today. Okay, so I'll tell you a little bit about them. Okay, so I want to say something about the socio-political context, which I've mentioned here. Okay. So the first is the changing demographics in schools and society. I don't want to be a person who says, you know, our society is changing so much, it's never been like this. Well, it's true, it's never been like this. But when I was a kid growing up in Brooklyn, New York, I went to a very diverse school. So diversity has been a fact of life in our society forever. You know, I went to school with other Puerto Rican kids, African American kids, immigrants from Italy, from Germany, from Russia, and other Caribbean kids as well. And so maybe diversity was not so evident in small towns and in the Midwest, for example, but it certainly is now. And so we need to be aware of the fact that by 2042, we will have reached the tipping point where more than half of the people in the United States will be people of color. That's 30 years away. And will we be prepared for that? We certainly are not right now. Yet teachers represent only about 17%, and that's a generous number, I think, of teachers of color. The majority of our teachers are white, monolingual English speaking. And this is not to say that white, monolingual English speaking teachers cannot teach a wide variety of students. In fact, they must. They have to. You know, it should not be the responsibility of only like Puerto Rican teachers to teach Puerto Rican students and black teachers to teach black students and so on. We don't want that kind of society. We want a society where every teacher is a teacher of all children and takes that responsibility. But it does make a difference when you have a more diverse teaching staff and administrators. Because I know from my own experience, when I was a teacher in the first school that I taught in Brooklyn, they had never heard of what a Puerto Rican teacher looked like. you know, or was like. And I know that not because I had anything, you know, special to contribute, but I did have something special to contribute in that they had never heard the perspective of a Puerto Rican teacher before. And so everybody has something special to contribute. But when you have everybody who is from the same background and similar experiences, you're not going to get that richness. And so that's why I always said at UMass, at the University of Massachusetts, where I was a professor, you know, that I was bringing something different. They didn't have too many Puerto Rican professors there. Just like every woman brought a different perspective to a place that was very male-dominated, where every other person of color, where every international faculty member or student brought a different perspective. And so that's what I mean by, you know, the demographic changes and how we need to get real in terms of making sure that our schools are more representative of our society. Segregated schools. As we know, our schools today are more segregated according to race, ethnicity, and social class than they ever have been before. And so, unfortunately, zip codes matter. And the kind of education that kids get too often depend on where they live. And we know that in a society that claims that there's equal education for all, we cannot continue to have this this situation. Next is the widely touted achievement gap. And you'll notice that I put it in quotes. I don't like that term. In my conversation with the students before, somebody brought up the term underperforming. And I said, I also don't like that term, underperforming, because it puts the onus, in both of these cases, on the students, as if they just decided to be underperforming one day. Or as if, you know, they have this achievement gap because they're lazy or they don't care. And so it takes the onus away from the situation that created that gap in the first place. The situation of racist schools, of unresponsive policies and practices, and so on. So I use achievement gap because, of course, there is an achievement gap. There is a gap. But as I said, this puts the, you know, this is embedded firmly in the student, and it shouldn't be. But the other thing is that I like to talk about other gaps. The opportunity gap. The opportunity gap is the fact that some students have many opportunities and other students do not. And so when we wonder why some students do so well and other students do so poorly, we need to say, what opportunities have they had? You know, like right now, my grandchildren, my little grandchildren, go to a school where they'll get music instruction starting in fourth grade. And sometimes they have like three kids learning how to play violin for, you know, an hour a week. You don't get that in some urban school, in most urban schools, you know. Kinds of opportunities, whether it's sports, it's music, it's art, or it's simply the attention of a teacher because they have smaller classes and so on. So the opportunity gap is one of the gaps that I'd like to focus on. Another one is the resource gap, which is closely related to the opportunity gap. The resource gap is how are the schools resourced? Are they underfunded or are they overfunded compared to the ones that don't have as many resources? And so that will make a difference in the kinds of opportunities that young people have. And finally, the caring gap. And so what I mean by that is that teachers who have not had personal or professional experience with students of diverse backgrounds often don't know how to care for them. They don't know what's expected. They don't know too much about them. And so I'm not saying that they couldn't learn these things. Of course, they can learn these things. But because of the lack of experience, they don't know. And so the first thing that I always say is that if you're going to be a teacher of students who are different from you, the first thing you need to do is learn who they are. Learn about them. Otherwise, you're going to have that caring gap. Okay, the next is the growing standardization and bureaucratization that have been brought about by policies and by legislation such as No Child Left Behind and Now Race to the Top, and other accountability structures that promote a climate of teaching to the test, and that really lead to frustration, even fraud in some cases, some very very visible cases of teachers who have cheated and taught their kids how to cheat so that they would not be quote underperforming. And so the common discourse now is about AYP, you know, annual yearly progress, and about rubrics and templates and so on. We don't hear words such as love, caring, you know, the whole child, all these things that we used to talk about. We don't hear a lot of language around that. Inadequate and irrelevant professional development, and I'll say a little bit more about that, but basically what I mean by that is that, you know, like one of the teachers who I've worked with, Mary Cowie, says, you know, I want meaningfully relevant professional development. I don't want to, you know, just sit in the auditorium because the principal said that this is important to know. And so teachers' voices are really missing in the whole conversation about what should happen in schools and in classrooms. So teachers are disempowered, their students are disempowered, and often teachers have nothing to say about the professional development that they'll have. And there are some excellent models of professional development. For example, the National Writing Project that's right here in the Bay Area, that started right here. My daughter has gotten very involved in the Western Massachusetts Writing Project, and it's a professional development structure that respects teachers, that honors their intelligence, that sees them as lifelong learners. It's very different from just being made to sit and listen to somebody who's telling them what to do. So, and then I want to say something about the current discourse. Yes, sorry. Oh, sorry. The structure and social inequality in schools and society, and let me just go on to the next one, because there we see what I mean by structural inequality, and you'll see I put poverty in the middle, but it's not always poverty. It's not only social class, as some people claim. It also is about lack of resources at home and at school, racism and other personal institutional biases, unfair policies and practices in schools and society, and the poor infrastructure in schools. So, you know, some people say, well, it's only poverty. Well, it's poverty has a great deal to do with the inequality. But even with young people who are middle class but are African American or Latino, they still suffer the consequences of inequality, and that inequality is based on race and ethnicity and on expectations that teachers might have of them or that schools might have of them. I can't tell you, for example, how many times I've heard of young people who are students of color and walk into like an honors class, and the teacher will say, are you sure you're supposed to be here? Because they think that they don't quite belong there. So even when students, you know, don't suffer the effects of poverty, they suffer the effects of other kinds of low expectations. Next. And so I wanted to just go over some of the current discourse that we hear in education, that teachers are seen as a little more than test preppers, you know, teaching students, preparing students to take tests, and as teachers needing surveillance and fixing, because, you know, we can't trust them to do things on their own. And as students as what I've called walking sets of deficiencies, or trouble or a challenge or a problem. Walking sets of deficiencies, you know, is that deficit model of what they don't know, what they can't do, who they are not. You know, it's all about the deficits. And so I want to change that discourse, and I think we all have a responsibility to do that, whether you're in education or not, and to challenge that discourse, just as people living in the United States, that teachers are intellectuals and problem solvers, and we have to restore that to teachers or create it. That teachers are creative change agents, and that students are also a joy and a possibility in spite of the challenges that they may be facing. Okay. So how does this context get in the way of thriving? This is an example of a climate of disrespect for teachers. This is an example of pressures to teach to the test. And let me tell you a little bit about Mary Ginley. She just retired recently after 42 years of teaching. She was an amazing teacher. She, in fact, was the Massachusetts Teacher of the Year about 12 years ago. And then she retired, moved to Florida, and decided to teach for 6 more years. So she just retired. And she when she was teaching, she would write I guess we would call it a blog now, but it was an email to a listserv of friends and family every week about what the school week had been like. Every Friday she'd write it. So she wrote one on her not the last year, the year before the last year that she taught. It was her 40th year of teaching, and this was the first entry that she had that year, that August. And so, yes. So this is what she wrote. Rebecca walked in the first day chewing gum and declared, "Just want you to know, I hate school." Mary taught fifth grade that year. "Everything?" said I. "Everything," she said. "Hmm," said I. "Guess I've got a big job ahead of me." "What job?" she asked. "Well, my goal is for you to say, I love school by Friday." "Think I can do it?" "No way." "Yes way," I said. "Now get rid of the gum and find your name tag, honey. We're almost ready to start." As she left today, and this was Friday, as I said, she hugged me and whispered, "I love school." And Mary continues, "Obviously, this is the best week of school until the FCAT, which of course is their high stakes test." She said, "For the kids, anyway. Teachers, on the other hand, feel as if they have been run over by a very large truck. It's the only week before FCAT when we do not have to follow any particular schedule, when we can take time to connect, to get procedures in place, to begin to build a community. But Monday, bam, we start story number one in the reading book." And she says, "Ha," because the reading book doesn't really have reading. It doesn't really have literature in it. And she said, and unit one in math, and things get rolling big time. It won't be so great next week, so my goal is for Rebecca to continue to love it, or at least like it. She has terrible trouble in math and reading. Hard to love school when you're constantly asked to do things that look impossible." So I emailed back, and I said, "You're an amazing teacher, and I'm sure that Rebecca will do much better this year for having you as a teacher." And she wrote back and she said, "Rebecca isn't really turned around. She just had a good first week because the work was doable and there was a lot of getting to know you kind of stuff. Lots of laughs, lots of 'you are so smart' every time someone offered an opinion about anything. Next week, when they start the serious grade level stuff and she realizes that it's going to be hard, things may fall apart. I'm going to do my best to see that they don't, but no matter what I say or do, when I hand them those stupid weekly tests, they are so sure that they're stupid. Or maybe this year I won't hand them the stupid weekly tests and let the chips fall where they may." Excuse me, I'm dry. Okay, so... And she was a bit of a rebel. She didn't completely throw away those stupid weekly tests, but she could get away with a lot because she was such a fabulous teacher. Her kids always did well, and they always improved. So, another example. So this is Steve Gordon. He was in this group that I told you about in Boston of high school teachers. We did an inquiry group together. He was an English teacher and very involved in the writing project. Also, in fact, he retired about 5 years ago, because we did this group about 12 years ago. He retired 5 years ago, and he's still very heavily involved in being a coach to teachers, and he's just a magnificent teacher. And this is what he wrote while we were meeting at the school. He said, "I am not looking for prescriptions for teachers. I'm not looking for narrow silver bullet programs that script teacher behaviors using some quasi-scientific rationale. I want to find ways to teach that embody the several theories and beliefs that I have come to believe are good and true. Truths and knowledge that have consequences for educating urban children. I can do little about the injustice and racism that permeate our institutions. But I want to create pedagogy that makes me feel I have done my best." And to me, he's the epitome of what a wonderful teacher is, because he recognizes all the injustices, but he knows that he can do something. That he can do something. He can't do everything, but he can do something. Yes. Next. So what do the current discourse, especially through No Child Left Behind and Race to the Top and so on, what do they say is needed to prepare highly qualified teachers? And these are some of the things. Test scores, their own test scores, because there are a lot of teacher tests. The test scores of students, which is now called value-added assessments, that teachers are rated largely on how their students do on standardized tests. So if their students happen to do well, the teachers will be kept. If not, they may be fired. And in fact, in New York City, they published the whole list of teachers whose kids did not do well on tests without taking into account the kind of resources that they have in some schools and lack of resources that they have in others. And I also want you to understand, I'm not defending all teachers. I'm just saying that there are a lot of good or excellent or potentially good teachers, and we can't just turn our backs on them and say that it's okay to evaluate them in this way. And we also look at the grades they had in school, for example. So, but what does the literature say? The literature, if you look at the literature on effective teachers, it says that effective teachers have a solid general education background, that they have a deep knowledge of their subject matter, and for elementary school teachers, it means that they have a really good understanding of all the subject matters that they'll be teaching, that they're familiar with a lot of pedagogical strategies, that they have strong communication skills, and that they are able to organize effectively. Now, I think we can all agree that those are all good things. All good things. But what do teachers say? So, yes, next. So that's why I wanted to tell you a little bit about my project today. What do teachers say makes an effective teacher? And we can learn so much from teachers who are being left out of the conversation about what makes for effective teaching, what teachers need to know, and so on. So, next. This is Angeles Perez. She is a fourth grade bilingual teacher in her second year of teaching when I interviewed her. That was 2 years ago in the Sheldon Independent School District in Texas. And she beams when she talks about her students. They're her buddies, she says. And she continues, next. And she says, "I make it a point every day to greet them at the door. I'm at the door, I'm smiling. And at the end of each day," she says, "I leave with a hug and they run to me and give me a hug, and it's the best feeling because they care so much about me that they will do for me. They will work for me because they know I work for them. I love them." And so this issue, you know, it's been found time and again in research that's been done on who students most relate to. They relate to teachers who make them work hard and who care for them. Both things. Who have high expectations for them, don't let them get away with stuff, but who clearly care for them. So this is Roger Wallace. He's at the other end of the spectrum in terms of his life experience, of his teaching experience. He is a veteran teacher, and he's been the only African-American male teacher in his school since he began teaching there 37 years ago. He lives and teaches in my hometown, and he has an amazing reputation. He had not originally planned to become a teacher, but rather a juvenile justice teacher. He'd always loved working with kids, and he did well on the law boards and gained admission to the Virginia University School of Law, a very fine law school. But he abandoned the idea of law after he became hooked on teaching in his senior year in college, when he had an internship in an after-school program in Worcester, Massachusetts. He found the work so rewarding that he thought, yes, where can I work with a body of kids before they get into a great deal of trouble? And so he said, it has to be in a school. So immediately after graduation, he became a teacher. And he was the fourth person, the fourth choice of four people who they interviewed. And, you know, he didn't have experience and so on. But he did say to the principal, I know I'm not your first choice, your second choice, or your third choice, but I will work harder than anybody you ever met. And he has. So I interviewed Angeles and Roger, along with about 18 other teachers, about half of them teachers of color, for my new book, and I'd like to focus on them today. There are white teachers, of course, but this work, actually, I wrote for a magazine called Teachers of Color Magazine, so I want to highlight the work that teachers of color do. So, let's see. Okay, next. So, Angeles Perez. She was 22 years old when I interviewed her. And as I said, Roger had been teaching for 37 years, so they're quite different in many ways. Now, she jokes that she's a Puerto Rican transplant in a heavily Mexican-American community in Texas. But she challenges the stereotype that all Latinos are alike. She's made it her responsibility to learn about her students' Mexican and Central American backgrounds, because she says if her students' identities are visible in the curriculum, then learning is more exciting for them and they become better writers and more enthusiastic learners. So she makes sure to be a culturally competent teacher by including their realities in the curriculum, and also by honoring who they are and their families. At the same time, she insists that each student is also an individual and that it's the teacher's responsibility to figure each student out and then tap into his or her interests. She's a fourth grade teacher, as I said, bilingual teacher of language arts, social studies, and ESL. And she teaches in a school where 87% of the students are Latinos and Latinas, and 96% are classified as economically disadvantaged. She said that she purposely chose this school because so many of the students live in poverty and they deserve excellent teachers, and she knew she was going to be an excellent teacher ever since she decided to be a teacher. So in explaining her decision, she says that it's not fair that children who live in poverty and attend poorly resourced schools are rejected, she said. Yes. She said, I read a book that said all the great teachers want to go to all the great schools. But what about the kids that it's not their fault? Maybe they're economically disadvantaged, so you're going to get stuck with the leftovers? And here she's just reiterating the reality that new inexperienced teachers who may become excellent teachers in the long run, but are put into the most difficult circumstances. And that's why they often leave after such a short time. And yet the more experienced teachers go to the more heavily resourced schools, but where they're needed is in the under-resourced schools with students who have not had the opportunities that middle-class kids have had. So next. So she was 22 years old, as I said, and when she talks about teaching, it's clear that she's wise beyond her years. She just bubbled over with enthusiasm. She's one of the most enthusiastic teachers I've ever met. She calls her students, who are fourth graders, her babies, saying, you know, I'm their biggest fan. And about teaching, she said, I come out of school and I feel like a really cool person, because these kids just bring you up, and I like to think that I do the same for them. Imagine if every teacher left school every day thinking, I am a really cool person because I'm teaching these kids. For example, given the low status of bilingual programs in most schools, and in some states, as we know, in California and in Massachusetts, it's been eliminated by ballot. So it has a low status in many places. So she says that she was ecstatic when one of her students in the school, in the bilingual program, won the spelling bee in English. And this was unheard of. And she says, that for me was so big that I felt like I won the spelling bee. Their success is my success, I guess. So getting to know students, Angeles says that she achieves her objectives by making sure to set aside time to get to know each of her students. For one, she has a built-in, what she calls a hanging out time for her, which is more important than anything else. She said it's a time to get to know your kid. And so at the end of every day, they have 10 minutes to hang out, when they can talk about anything with her, confide in her, ask her questions, and so on. And she recounts the story of a mother who came to see her in tears because her son had never been very happy in school before this year that he was in Angeles's class. And the mother said, Angeles says, he had told her that since my name is Angeles, I was an angel for him because he'd never had a teacher understand him before. For me, that day I cried. I cried my eyes out because it was just goes to show that they know when you care, and if you show them you care, and they will work for you. And just from these two teachers, we can learn so much. So in terms of teaching Latino students, these are the kinds of things that are important to Angeles. Thriving as a teacher goes beyond students scoring well on tests. She said, I guess I'm thriving in that my kids are successful not only based on the state standards, because they're successful on that, which is a big part in Texas, but beyond that, they learned and they were excited to learn. They didn't want to leave my room. And I have to say that she was in her second year of teaching, actually, when I interviewed her. And she said the first year nobody paid much attention to her. She was a newbie. They figured, what does she know? You know, she's 21 years old. At the end of the year, her students did so well on the state test that all of a sudden people started paying attention to her. So she said, I feel like I'm thriving in the fact that tax in Texas is on the side burner. I know they're going to succeed in that. So to accomplish this, she says that she helps students set high goals for themselves at the beginning of the year. She works with each student to ask what goal they have, and she helps them set really high goals. But happy as she was with the test results, she said that seeing her students learn to accept who they are and to be happy with themselves is her greatest accomplishments. So her advice is to get to know your students, and these are some of the things that I've just mentioned: setting up a hanging out time, showing care. And care is not just a pat on the back and not a hug, although for her it's also a hug. But I also say to people, you know, she's Puerto Rican, you can expect her to hug her students. You know, that's just what happens. And Mexican Americans, it's the same. Not every teacher is comfortable with that, and they don't have to be. So, you know, I remember a teacher who was a kindergarten teacher at our local elementary school, and my granddaughter, who my husband and I have raised, was going to be going to kindergarten, and I said to a friend of mine, but you know, I hear that she doesn't hug students. How could you be a kindergarten teacher and not hug students? And this woman said to me, she hugs them with her eyes. And she did. She was a fabulous teacher. So glad we left her there. She hugged them with her eyes. So affection isn't always just, you know, a hug. It's having high expectations for them. It's having rigorous demands. It's having admiration for the students and their families. And this is something else that I just want to point out, that often, you know, that sometimes teachers feel that they're in school to sort of save these kids. And instead of that perspective, I think it's important, and so that means that they don't have very much respect for their families. And instead, I think that really successful teachers are not there to save the kids. They are there to work with them. They are there to get to know the families and to work with them as well. It's not a savior mentality that will help kids succeed in school. And so beyond having students score well on tests, as she said, she affirms their identity, she sets goals with them. And I just want to say a word about transcending their identities, because who they are is very important, but there's a whole world out there. And they also need to learn what that whole world is like. It's not just focusing on who they are, but learning about others. And I often give the example of when I was a kid, my favorite book was Heidi. Now, Heidi had nothing to do with an urban Puerto Rican child in a ghetto neighborhood in Brooklyn. I lived on a fifth floor walk-up. That was the highest I ever got. You know, I never went to a mountain like Heidi lived in the mountains with her grandfather. And yet, why was that my favorite book? I don't know. It said something to me about family, about reading. She loved reading. I also loved Little Women, and I could really identify with that. I didn't just have to read stories about Puerto Ricans, although I would have loved to read some, because I never read one. But it's about transcending identity as well, and knowing that there's a whole big world out there. So yes, teach them about who they are, and respect and affirm that, and also teach them many other things so that the world of opportunities can be opened up to them. Okay, this is Roger Wallace. And as I said, he's a veteran sixth grade teacher in the Amherst, Massachusetts public schools. He has a legion of fans in town. As the only African-American male teacher in his school, it's the expectation of many people of color in the community that he will teach their children. Although many, many white families also covet a place in his class. And so he's taught a range of students over the years. The school is quite diverse, with about 65% white students, and with African Americans, Latinos and Latinas, Cambodians and others making up the remainder. In terms of social class, the students range from very wealthy to those who live in poverty. So Roger believes that there's no greater calling than teaching. And as a black man, he says that he has certain responsibilities. Part of his cultural legacy, he said when I interviewed him, is to accept all children for who they are rather than what he or anyone else expects them to be. He explained, for instance, that some white teachers expect children of color to be just like the white kids. But he says, can you teach them as they are instead of I'll teach them when they become what I want and then they'll be ready to learn? A wonderful, wonderful point for all teachers to remember. You know, we don't just teach them when they get to where we think they should be, or when they're like everybody else, all right? And he also said that to be a successful teacher, if you want to be a successful teacher of children of diverse backgrounds, put your stuff away. So what did he mean by that? What do you think he meant by that? Let me open it up and ask you. I'm tired of hearing my voice, so. What does he mean? Put your stuff away.
Your biases.
Yeah, your biases, definitely.
Judgment.
What?
Judgment.
Judgment. Yeah, your preconceived ideas. You know, start thinking differently. Start understanding that not everybody is like you. You have to put your stuff away. And think about things, even if it's very hard to do, trying to put yourself in the, you know, vantage point of others. But it also means recognizing your own positionality, recognizing who you are and what you bring to the teaching experience. Yeah, next. He says he thrives by keeping teaching new. No two groups of kids are alike, and as a result, every class, when students ask him, so are we your favorite class? Which is your favorite class? He says, every class is my favorite class. So they'll say, are we your favorite class? He always says yes. And he gives his all to teach each of the students he's taught, although he has challenging students each year. He told a story about his stepfather to describe how he views these challenges. So he said his stepfather was a skilled carpenter, and he told Roger, you know, there's never a bad piece of wood. There's only wood that needs extra planing. You know? You have to find the right purpose for that piece of wood. So that's his philosophy, Roger's philosophy for teaching as well. He pushes for excellence with each student by listening and learning from them. This is what it means to create a more empowered learner and a more inclusive learning environment. He also said that teaching is about trust. So I'm going to share the laundromat metaphor with you. He shows this trust, for example, by going to his students' homes to help them organize their rooms so that they can study more effectively. Like every once in a while, he says, this particular kid is not studying well, so he'll call the parent and say, can I come over? I want to see where, you know, Juanito studies. And he'll help him figure it out. Parents don't say no to Roger. You know, they know. He also gives every student his home number and his cell number. And the only thing that he asks is that they know how to converse with the person who answers. And not to say, Mr. Wallace there? But instead say, hi, Mrs. Wallace, this is such and such. Is Mr. Wallace there? Can I speak with him? And so on. So he builds relationships with parents by meeting them where they will feel comfortable. So this is the laundromat metaphor. He says, I thrive because I like to have parent conferences in laundromats. If I know a parent goes to a laundromat on Thursdays, I show up with clean hands and an attitude to fold everything but the underwear. He says he has the country doctor philosophy because education is not a 9-to-3 job. He sees himself not only as a teacher, but also a friend, a neighbor, a counselor to his students. He makes sure that every child in his class, as I said, has his phone number and feels free to call him anytime. Does this mean every good teacher needs to do this? No. I interviewed another teacher who said, I never give my home number to my students. You know, I'm there for them all the time, but you know, I need to be there for myself sometimes too. So this is not a template of what makes an excellent teacher. There are many ways to be an excellent and caring teacher. These are some of the ways that these teachers connect with their students. Yeah. So teaching is more than content. He says that you know, it's also about helping students figure out who they are and what will help them learn. He said that to be successful with students of color, you have to love them for 6.5 hours to 7 hours every day, 180 days, and you have to stick with them. So he says, to teach kids of diverse backgrounds, you have to be someone who can shuffle a lot of cards. He likes metaphors. These cards include being effective with white students as well, many of whom have been changed forever because of having had Roger as a teacher. So, teaching students of diverse backgrounds effectively means being a lifelong learner. Yes. It means confronting your own biases and assumptions, as we said. I think that every teacher, to really become an effective teacher of any student, no matter where you live and work, needs to confront their own position in society, their own biases, their own perceptions that get in the way of their teaching, particularly with students of diverse backgrounds. Learn to say all students' names correctly. This sounds like such a little thing, and I put it up there with larger things because it's huge. When Juan becomes John, something is taken from his personality. When a parent says, it's okay, you can call her Susie, even though her name is Su Jin, that's a parent giving you permission for something that is going to take part of the identity from their student, from their children. That parent is trying to be accommodating and respectful of a teacher. But when that happens, please say to the parent, "Oh, I can learn her name. Can you teach me how to say it?" I've heard so many cases of children whose names have been changed. In fact, I'll share something with you. My maiden name, so-called maiden name, is Cortez, spelled the right way, C-O-R-T-E-S. That's the only way to spell it. It's true. It's really true. That's the way to spell it. Cortez, it means courteous. Cortez with a Z doesn't mean anything. It doesn't really exist in our countries of origin. And so the interesting thing is that half of my cousins, the ones who were raised in the United States, spell their last name with a Z, and half of us with an S. Why is that? Because the teachers retaught them how to spell it, quote, correctly. But if you go to Puerto Rico, you don't see Cortez with a Z unless they happen to be return migrants, you know, who are going back from here. So learn to say students' names. Smile before Christmas. Isn't this the kind of you know, advice that you always get? Don't smile before Christmas. And when I was interviewing Angeles, I said, so, because she was talking about smiling so much, so I said, "So do you smile before Christmas? Didn't you get that, you know, that memo that you don't smile before Christmas?" She said, "Not smile before Christmas. If you don't smile before Christmas, you don't have a relationship with your students." So this is good advice. I'm putting little things with big things because I think they're really important. Next. Bring your own and your students' identities into the classroom. You know, students want to know that you're a real person. This doesn't mean you have to share all your most intimate details with them, but it does mean that they need to see you as a real person. You know, my daughter, who's a teacher, as I mentioned, often says that that's how she connects with a lot of her students. Of course, she sees them in the community also, but when they see her children, they'll say, "Oh, is that Clarita or Lucia?" You know, so they'll know something about her life. Let them bring their identities into the classroom, too. It makes a huge difference. In my first teaching job, when I was a middle school teacher, I remember I was talking to kids about Thanksgiving, about, you know, we were going to have a few days off, and so I said, "How are you going to celebrate Thanksgiving?" And, you know, they gave all the politically correct answers. "Oh, we're having turkey, and we're having mashed potatoes, and we're having, you know, so and so forth." I said, "Really? Oh, well, we're having that too, but we're having arroz con gandules, and we're having pernil also, which is another meat." And some of the kids, their eyes just flew open. They said, "You eat that stuff too?" Made a huge difference. It gave them permission to say, "Oh yeah, we're having that too at our house," you know, because otherwise they'd be ashamed to say it. So, you know, it's important to bring that into the classroom. Encourage your students to speak their native languages. I know you have eliminated bilingual education here, but that doesn't mean that they can't use their language in school. And so find ways to have them use their language. You know, teachers who have been effective teachers, for example, label everything in the languages that the children speak so that they see their language up. That's, you know, you're not teaching them in that language, but you are showing them that you respect that language. Or even having them work in cooperative groups and allowing them to use their native language. Encouraging families to keep speaking whatever their native language is at home, instead of in my case when I was a kid, that we spoke only Spanish when we went to school, and my mother was told that she should speak only English with us at home. She didn't pay any attention to that, thank goodness. But a lot of parents do, unfortunately. And so what does that mean? Communication is cut off between, especially if the parents are immigrants and don't speak very much English. And so then you can't have much communication. So these are all things that I hope teachers are saying nowadays, but I know that it's not true. I know that there are still teachers who say, for your child to do better in school, you really need to speak English at home. And what they should be saying instead is, your child will do much better in school if you keep speaking Spanish at home, home, read them stories in Spanish, tell them jokes in Spanish, and so their literacy will develop. You know, those tongue twisters that I heard in Spanish really helped me. The riddles that my mother told me in Spanish helped me to understand that there was literacy in Spanish. Next. Learn another language. That's really important. Now, I would say learn the language that the majority of you students speak, but it would make a big difference, but it really doesn't matter in some ways what language you learn. What matters is that you go through the process of being a second language learner. And I know in California there are a lot of people who speak 2, 3, 4 languages, but I would encourage all teachers to learn another language, because when you go through that process, you learn insights that otherwise you would never know. Because I've had students who have become second language learners, they learn to understand why their students make the mistakes that they do, for example. They learn how exhausting it is to learn another language. They learn that in 1 year you can't expect a kid to be proficient in English if they've never spoken it before. They learn many, many important lessons. Next. Become a member of the community. So what do I mean by this? I mean not necessarily moving into a community, although you can do that, but you don't have to move into a community to be part of a community. And that means not seeing the school as isolated from the community, but rather bringing the community into the school, bringing the school out into the community. So almost all the teachers who I've interviewed have said they go to birthday parties and quinceañeras and bar mitzvahs, and they'll go to the places of worship, and they'll see the students in the community. And that really makes a bond with the students who they teach. Feel comfortable going into a bodega and buying, you know, your food there. Going to the record store and listening to the music that your students listen to and buying some of that music. That's what I mean by being a member of the community. That's why I think it's exciting that Mills is doing this cooperative venture with communities, with community colleges, which, you know, I think is tremendous. So that's what it means to become a member of the community. Next. So what can we learn from Angeles and Roger? So even these are brief glimpses into their world. We've seen that for thriving teachers, first of all, teaching is an act of love. Effective teachers know that students who feel loved and valued are free to learn. So teaching is primarily about forging a connection with students, not just teaching the curriculum, and that's where the title of this talk comes from. Teaching students of diverse backgrounds means moving from deficit to asset, not what they don't know and can't do, but what they do know and can do. And so if we started with that perspective, it would mean a world of difference. Rather than, for example, being seen as a non-English speaker when I started school, it would have been great if I had been seen as a Spanish speaker. You know, you're just turning that on its head and thinking, what does this child bring to his or her education? Because every child brings something. Effective teachers are learners of themselves, their content, their students, and their families, as I've mentioned before. And effective teaching takes a combination of courage and humility. And I want to say a little bit about this. This is Adam Heenan. Let's see, is Rick Ayers here? He was going to come with his students. Do you know Adam?
No.
So Adam is one of the teachers that I recently interviewed. So Adam is, you know, I had to interview him as soon as I saw him in Chicago wearing this t-shirt. I am a teacher, right? And he said that it's a group that is proclaiming their voice, their teacher voice, and it's sort of modeled after the civil rights movement when black men walked with those billboards that said, I am a man. And it's the same sort of feeling, I am a teacher. And he said that Bill Ayers taught him to have, well, I think I have it afterwards, but first, when I interviewed, he said, it's not only, you know, what I do, he said, but for what am I doing it, for what am I doing it? And so I decided this is a way for me to serve my community. And this is what he learned from Bill. He said, good teaching requires audacity, but demands humility. So he has one tattoo on one arm, another tattoo on another arm in Greek. One says audacity, one says humility. He looks down every day to look at them. So this is the kind of teacher that I think exemplifies, you know, being a culturally competent, excellent, and caring teacher. And so are Roger and Angelis. So I'll end with, do I have another slide? Yeah. Just with their pictures. I want to reiterate the fact that Roger and Angelis are very different in many ways. They teach differently. They don't follow a so-called best practices approach to their work as if there were any such thing. I have to say that I believe that this focus on best practices is a wrong-headed approach. There are no best practices. There are some practices that will work with some students, other practices will work with other students. You have to try everything. But there's no such thing as best practices, and yet, you know, we're in this sort of limited, rigid way of understanding teaching. And they don't follow that. But they do share an outlook of teaching that transcends gender, race, and experience. It's an outlook that views each child, regardless of background or circumstance, as a learner capable of great things, now and in the future. Thank you very much. So, I think that Ingrid has a, do you have a mic? Yeah.
A mic, and we hope you have questions.
So now I can walk around a little bit.
Any questions?
I was wondering as far as...
So wait for the mic, and that way everybody can hear you.
Okay, so my question was something that I'm always kind of thinking of, is we have this great need for more educators, people of color that become educators. So how, for us that are not of color, how can we teach in a way that will encourage our children to grow up and become educators without being able to be that role model of being someone of color?
Because you would be a different kind of role model. I mean, that's, I don't know if you were here at the beginning, but I said that, you know, I'm not saying that the only effective teachers for students of color are teachers of color. I think that would give the wrong message. In fact, so many of the young people who I've spoken to have talked about a teacher who changed their life, who's somebody from a different background, not their background. So I think what it takes is for teachers of all backgrounds to be caring, loving, attentive, and learners. Because, look, as a Puerto Rican woman, for example, I'm not automatically an excellent teacher of Puerto Rican students, right? I have an advantage. But my experience as an urban New York Puerto Rican, or New Yorican as we say, is different from somebody who comes from a small town in Puerto Rico who's never been to New York or the United States. So, you know, even, and for example, as a Puerto Rican, I couldn't automatically, as a so-called person of color, even though I'm a, you know, light-skinned, I'm a white-looking Puerto Rican, as I say, I couldn't be expected to be an excellent teacher of Vietnamese students or African American students. Yes, we have some things in common, but there are many, many, many things that we don't. And so my responsibility as a teacher is to learn about all of those students in order to be an effective teacher of those students. So that's what I mean. That's why I love this issue of humility. Because humility means that you have to learn who your students are and recognize that you don't know everything. And furthermore, that you will never know everything. That's very humbling. And so as a white teacher of white students, you'll also not know everything, ever. So I think it's just a matter of saying, I have a lot to learn. I have a lot to learn. And not to beat yourself up if you make mistakes, if you say the wrong thing, you know? Because some people are so afraid of that, then they walk away from issues instead of confronting them. If you make a mistake, say, I'm sorry, and keep going on from there. You know?
Other questions?
Yes.
That is like your two examples, but the administrator is not always supportive.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, this is where I say that individual teachers should not attempt to work by themselves, because it won't get them very far. They'll just be seen as the sore thumb, the, you know, the troublemaker, and so on. You're going to be, you know, you're going to have that anyway, enough. So what I would say is that, you know, what I always encourage people to do is to make a friend, especially new teachers. They say, I really like all these ideas, but how am I going to do it when I'm a new teacher and I'm going to a school that might not support these things? I always say, make a friend. Start by developing some allies. And so you start with one, then you add another one, and before you know it, you might have five or six people who can then go to the principal and say, we have drawn up a proposal for professional development that is different from what we've had, and we think it makes more sense, and so on and so forth. I mean, it's that kind of work that will get more, it'll have a better result than simply one teacher working individually who's going to be positioned as a troublemaker.
So. Teachers here in California are asked to be culturally competent. Part of your kind of evaluation that's expected of you.
That's the CLAD, isn't it?
Right. So then, but in becoming culturally competent and thinking about what that continuum looks like, mm-hmm. what does it look like?
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, you're giving me a great opportunity to make a plug for a wonderful award that, how many of you get Teaching Tolerance magazine? Great, great. And those who don't, please subscribe. It's free, has great ideas, it's a wonderful resource. So a project came out of Teaching Tolerance. Teaching Tolerance comes from the Southern Poverty Law Center that does so much wonderful work. Teaching Tolerance is this magazine. They have lots of resources and so on. And a project that came out of there that I'm the co-chair of the advisory committee for is called TDSI, Teaching Diverse Students Initiative. If you look it up on the web, you'll go right to the website. And last year we had the first award for culturally competent teachers. The call is out for this coming year. You can self-nominate, or you can have someone nominate you. You have to go through a process of submitting all this stuff. We had five teachers from five different regions or places in the country. We had lots of applications to go through, and it's a wonderful way to get this topic, you know, in the general public. The teachers are awarded $1,000 each. They're flown to Washington, D.C., and there was media around it. Education Week did something. There's a little video about each of the teachers. So I wanted to get in a plug for that. But I'm so glad you asked that question, because I never really defined it. And I guess I stay away from defining it because I'm afraid that people will grab onto, you know, some things that, and make it a template, and I don't want it to be that way at all. I would say that to be a culturally competent teacher means to be open and respectful of the identities of all students and their families. Now, that's extremely broad. But to me, it's not about learning, like, the cultural characteristics of each group, because that can really become laughable, you know? Let me give you an example from my own life. You know, as I think you know already, I'm Puerto Rican, right? So, I'm a different Puerto Rican from my mother and father. They came as adults to the United States. I was born here. My experiences are very different. We all speak Spanish. We still cook Puerto Rican food. Certainly have some of the family values. Not in the Republican way, but, you know, in the Puerto Rican way. So we still have those. And I have two daughters, really three, because I've raised a granddaughter. They are Puerto Rican in a different way than I am. And they're each different also. So there would be no list of characteristics that would encompass all of us. So when you go to that list of characteristics, you're in trouble. You know, we're in a slippery slope. So what it means to me to be a culturally competent teacher is to respect where students are coming from, learn who they are, learn who their families are, and communicate with them honestly, respectfully. I think it makes more sense for you, let's say if you have a class of students who are, you know, of varied backgrounds, learn a little bit of the history of each of those communities. The history is a much better way to go. You know, what has been the history of Cambodians in the United States? That's important to know. And of the complicit nature of the United States in creating those refugees because of the Vietnam War. That's important to know. So it means getting to know who your students are individually and as a group. More than anything else, that's what it is. So when you learn who they are, then you can incorporate some of that into the curriculum in a respectful and authentic way, rather than through some artificial, you know, inclusion of ethnic tidbits in the curriculum. Okay? So I'm sorry I can't be more specific, but, you know, it's like you'll know it when you see it. You know what I'm saying? When the teachers who we honored last year talked about their curriculum, their pedagogy, their outreach to families, they were all examples of being culturally competent. It means being respectful, being affirming, understanding who the kids are, relating to them, you know, in a caring way. That's what it means to me.
Other questions? Ruth, do you want to start?
I have a follow-up question to that one.
Okay, here. You want to take this, Ruth? There.
A follow-up question to that one. Mm-hmm. I, among other things, teach a sixth grade math class every day. And I have lots of ways to know whether or not I'm being mathematically proficient, whether or not I'm smart enough mathematically to do what I'm doing. But how do I assess myself in terms of cultural competence for the classroom and the kids that are now?
Yeah, that's a great question, because often people say, look, I understand cultural competence when you teach social studies or you teach English, because you can adapt the curriculum and so on. But with math and science, it's harder. It's harder, but not impossible. So I think the choice of topic, for example, and the examples that you give, for example, are good indicators. How you treat the students is a very good indicator. You know, we have so much evidence that shows that girls are not called on as often as boys, for example, in math class and in science class, and I think the same thing happens with a lot of kids of color. And so being fair is another way of finding out. I'll give you an example from science. I worked with a teacher who was a science teacher in the middle school. And she was going to be teaching them, what was she teaching them? I forget what kind of science, but she said she didn't teach anything about science content the first week, or even the first 2 weeks. What she did was to have, it's a very diverse community, what she did was have the students learn about and report on somebody who was like them, who was in science. So she said to me, okay, so the Cambodian woman scientist, that was hard to find, but not impossible. But all the students did research on somebody of their gender and race and or ethnicity or language. And then they had a big mural that they put up. And she said she kept it there for a long time because she wanted the kids to be able to look at that every day, that bulletin board rather, and say, they can do it, so can I. So to me, that's a good example of cultural competence. Thanks for the question. Yes.
In Oakland, we have a really good opportunity to go through these workshops.
You have a really good one, I'm sorry.
A good opportunity. And it was by Dr. Shraki Holly of culturally responsive. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's a terminology, but the point is, he posits that it's not enough for, as you said, to be the lone wolf. Mm-hmm. You've got to have the whole school.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you have no fighting chance. So he has a whole school. So from top, it's a small school. The staff is enough to have, you know, African-American teachers as models, if you have mostly or Latino teachers. Mm-hmm. But you have to have the whole structure to have a fighting chance.
Right.
Have you heard of this work, and how do you see that as being different or similar to what you're advocating or researching?
Yes, so tell me his name again.
Shraki Holly, I think some people will know.
Yeah.
And Dr. Nona Lemoine, he was a student of hers.
Okay. So I'm afraid that I haven't, so maybe he's someone who I have to learn about. Because often there's a big breach between the practitioners and the, you know, the college professors. And, you know, I try to bridge that gap, but obviously I don't know everybody who's doing this work. And so maybe what he needs to start doing also is to write about it and get it publicized, because it might be a great model. I don't see it as very different, you know, but I haven't been in school, so I don't know.
Maybe a follow-up then.
Yes.
Never mind the name of the person. What do you see as the difference between a school structured to be culturally responsive, mm-hmm, versus individual practitioners like myself, a teacher who hopes to become socially, I mean culturally, competent?
Yeah, I think, you know, what you mentioned about not having a fighting chance, well, I wouldn't put it so dismally. I think you have a fighting chance, but the difference that I see is that all the structures support the work that you're doing, you know? And in a really culturally competent or responsive school, you would look really critically at a lot of policies and practices, like disciplinary policies. Why is it that African-American and Latino males are so, so often disciplined more than others who have committed the same infractions? You know, you'd look at these things critically. Why is it that students who speak another language are not allowed to speak their language in school? Why is it that we don't do adequate outreach to families, but instead, you know, assume that the families don't care if they don't show up in school? So be looking critically at all of these policies and practices. That's what I think a school really needs to do. In fact, a few years ago, or for many years, in one of my classes, I would describe a, in one sentence, or a phrase, describe a philosophy that was trying to describe a school. So I would have the students get into four groups. One was, the philosophy was to create lots of workers and a few managers. Right? The other one was three groups. To develop critical thinkers. Another one was to affirm the identity of all students in a democratic society. So what we found was, the students got into the groups, and I said their job was to create the structure, the policies and the practices in that school that would identify that school as living by this philosophy. And to their horror, every semester that I did this, the students said, oh my God, that first school was the one like the ones that we know. That school that, trained some to be managers and many to be workers. And they looked at all the policies and practices and they said, oh, that's like the school that I work in. And the other schools, they dreamt, they designed these wonderful places, but that were quite different from the schools that they worked in. So I think that's why it's important to start from a philosophy. If this is your philosophy, what would your school look like? I know that we have a leadership program here. For those of you who are or are going to be principals, I think that's a very good strategy for you to think about. If you want to create a school that replicates inequality, how would you go about it? But if you want to create a school that is liberating, that is fair, that is equitable, how would you go about that? And then, if you start with a philosophy, the policies and practices sort of fall into place. Yes, hi.
Dr. Nieto, thank you for being here.
Oh, my pleasure.
I wanted to ask you about your experiences, particularly from a teacher education perspective, but also from some of the research you presented today around thinking, what's next? Where are we going with not just the discourse you're helping us utilize, but hopefully getting ahead of that and seeing a new generation of teachers out in our schools? So I'm wondering, in thinking about what's coming, what advice can you give us as teacher educators, as pre-service teachers in a program, as in-service teachers maybe wanting to be a part of this, I think, this movement around equity in schools? What type of things have you seen show up in your research that have impacted maybe these folks you presented, or what really makes a difference in their training or in their practice that could help us in the future?
You know, I really think that it's not about the methods that they learn. In fact, I was sharing today that I've been making a rather radical proposal lately, and that is that we should get rid of all methods classes. I'm sorry if you're in a methods class right now. But because I don't think that methods are the answer, and that we so easily, make that a fetish. That is, this method is going to be the be-all and end-all. I think instead we should have courses like creating multicultural learning communities, learning to work with families, or taking Luis Moll's work, using funds of knowledge in the curriculum, or in instruction. Those are the kinds of courses that I think we should have. For these particular teachers, I think some of them were lucky to go through good teacher education programs and others did not. And so they have varied kinds of experiences. What I think is that, what we need to teach future teachers, or even practicing teachers who need to get charged up again, is that more than anything, teaching is about a stance. A stance that you take, a stance towards social justice, a stance towards democratic practice, a stance toward, equity and equality, a stance toward diversity. and a stance toward yourself as a lifelong learner. because I think that that's really what it's about. This is why I love going to conferences, for example. I love being in different venues because I'm always learning. And as educators, we should always be learning. I think that life is so hard for many teachers today, so they don't read very much. And I think reading is essential to just keep up with everything, because you're not finished when you graduate with a degree in education. You're just starting. You're just starting. So I think all of those things are what I've seen have worked for people. They learn these things maybe through their teacher education programs, maybe through their relationships with other teachers. But you know what I think keeps teaching really fresh is always being engaged and always being involved, whether it's through professional organizations like the National Council of Teachers of English, National Council of Teachers of Mathematics, the National Writing Project, or having a network in the school, or having an out-of-school network, such as Rethinking Schools. How could we teach without rethinking schools if we have a social justice perspective? You know? So I think that creating those networks is really important. And the more you have them, the more you have, the more connected you'll feel and the more fresh you'll feel every time you go into the classroom. This is why Roger Wallace is such an inspiration. He's been doing this for 37 years. I remember about 20 years ago running into him in the summer, and it was like the end of July. I said, "So, Roger, you ready to go back to school?" You know, most teachers say, "Oh, well, I have another month," because it's hard. You know, teaching is hard. You need that, you know. And he said, "Oh, I can't wait to go back to school. 2 months is too long. No, it's too long. We need to get back." Now, I'm not saying everybody should be like that. Roger is, you know, unusual. But, in fact, he's going to be retiring soon, so it'll be interesting to see what he does with his time. Because teaching is so much a part of, you know, who he is. So, you know, there are many ways, as I said before, to be an excellent teacher. I think individually we have to find those ways, but I hope that I've given you some signposts, like, you know, keep on learning, keep on being engaged, keep on believing in students. I think all of those things are really important.
We have one more question. Yes?
Jack? Oh, good, my clicker. and thank you, by the way. Thank you so much.
Of course, thank you for being here. So I really respect the opinion that you gave on methods and the abolition of courses in college, because I did not enjoy mine. However, I learned a lot about the theories that we're trying to use to our advantage in teaching in a, like for example, at Mills, I'm a student teacher in our preschool, and I'm actually doing my thesis on how a constructivist approach benefits a classroom in different ways. And I think that utilizing methods to our advantage, such as having an open-ended curriculum in the classroom, can really be incorporated into what you said should be the alternative. And I'm not trying to be contrary. I think it's important to understand that our methods and observations that we're learning as students before going out to the world of education is like lacking, but I still think that we really need to pay attention to those, not while utilizing best practice, of course, but like while using it to our advantage. Mm-hmm.
You know, I couldn't agree with you more. So I didn't say that people should not learn methods. It's just that when you have an entire course called methods, that's what you fetishize. You know, and that you think that methods are going to get you there. But if you're taking a course called Creating Multicultural Learning Communities, you're going to learn lots of methods, some of which might work with you, some of which might not work, but the focus is different. So that's what I'm saying. And you gave the perfect example of constructivist teaching. Constructivist teaching, you see, I don't think that any of these things are best practices. I think that they are interesting and can be useful. But I read an article a couple of years ago by a great proponent and one of the people who really support constructive teaching, and she did a research project on it and found that unfortunately this is an approach that was used most often by teachers who didn't know enough content. Now, isn't that scary? And used with kids in under-resourced schools, not kids in middle-class schools. So the approach can be really beneficial and helpful, but it can go awry. And the same thing is true of cooperative learning, for example. That's a great method. It doesn't work in all circumstances with all teachers, and I've seen cooperative groups used in bad ways. So I think, what I would like teachers to develop is a critical stance toward any method, and yet to learn a whole bunch of them. And that's why I had that up there too, that teachers should learn a lot of pedagogical strategies. But I can assure you that the pedagogical strategies that I learned so many years ago are not even used today, probably. I don't even remember what they were. Because I learn with my colleagues, I learn on the job, I learn by experimentation. I did this in my teacher education classes too. I would, drop something that I was doing on a dime and then do something else because it was more relevant at the moment. And I would try something new and say, oh gee, I like how that worked. Or I would try something new and say, that didn't work out too well. So that's what I mean. I think we need to be experimenting, we need to be courageous, we need to be innovative. Mary Ginley, who I had up there, the teacher who taught for 42 years, wrote something once for a class that she took of me, and she said, I've been teaching, at that point it was like 30 years, I've been teaching for 30 years, and all I have are 2,000 children's books and some ideas about lessons. But every year she would throw out all her lesson plans for the year. Now that's a little extreme, because she was such a good teacher and she could have used some of that stuff, but she said she never wanted to use the same thing twice. She wanted to always be thinking about different things to do. So that's an attitude that I think is good.